Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for being here today. My name is Carsten Kükal, and I'm supporting TSI Fluid Mechanics and Aerosol Research customers in EMEA.
And my name is Andrea Tiwari, and I focus on supporting research and analytical instrument customers in North America and also globally.
This webinar is the first in a series of two. Today, we will focus on the issue of regulation and measurement protocol. The second webinar will take place in May with a focus on research. Next slide, please. For our regulation-focused webinar today, here's an outline of what we will discuss. First, we will go over the motivation for measuring braking emissions and what the true goals of those measurements are. Then we will dive into the brakeway emission measurement method as developed by a subcommittee of the PMP group in Europe. We will discuss not only the key elements that are included in this method, but also use data to demonstrate why each of those elements needs to be standardized in the protocol. At the end, we will show some example data from published papers, and we will also take a brief look at types of data that are not required by the protocol, but are valuable to have together with the solutions that can provide that data. Next slide, please. So let's start with the motivation. Why are people interested in brakeware? Speaking broadly, brake emissions contribute significantly to traffic-related air pollution. A recent study showed that brake emissions may be as toxic as diesel emissions. Diesel emissions have received a lot of scientific and regulatory attention, and the attention on brakeware emission is growing. Just as with soot particles from internal combustion emissions, brakeware emissions pose a public health hazard. So the question is, can we better understand this hazard and quantify the risk to public health? Next slide, please. But how do we do that? How do we assess the risk or this risk? Personal exposures and exposure patterns at the population level are certainly a part of that, but there's also an emissions inventory part. We need to know how much is being emitted. We need to be able to determine the particulate emissions from braking on a per distance driven basis. Those emissions need to be measured both in terms of mass and in terms of number. Next slide, please. Okay, now we know what we need to measure, but how do we do it? The answer is that a complex system is needed to get from brake assembly to an accurate measurement of the particles that can be emitted from that brake assembly. What is included in this complex system? A brake dynamometer, a brake enclosure, air handling, a sampling system, instruments to measure the particles online, instruments to sample the particles so they can be measured offline, and then offline sample analysis. Due to the number and diversity of these components, this is a complex system. Next slide, please. But please do not reinvent the wheel, so to speak. Doing so is time consuming and may not provide results comparable to what others are doing. There is a standard method developed by a task force of the PMP group in Europe. This task force includes professionals from numerous companies and universities, all of whom have prior experience measuring brake emissions. Following a developed protocol or method saves time and ensures comparability.
But this protocol is not yet accepted as a standard. An interlaboratory test is currently underway. We can say, though, that a regulation is anticipated to be established in approximately 2024, along with Euro 7. Working backward then from that time, test stands need to be outfitted during 2023, which means that 2022 is a key time for planning. Let's understand what this protocol contains so you can prepare to comply with the upcoming regulation. The first section of the protocol defines the test cycle. Sections 2 through 7 then describe how the system should be structured and operated. Then the last preparatory piece is number 8, characterizing losses within that test stand. Once those loss estimates have been completed, you're ready to move into the data that you need to gather, measurements of particle mass, or PM, and particle number, PN. So those are in 9 and 10. TSI has instrumentation that is relevant to sections 8 through 10 of this protocol. So as we go through the protocol today in the webinar, we'll introduce those instruments at that time. At the end of the protocol then, in section 11, the information that must be included in the final report is specified. Section 1 is about the test cycle. As you all know, brakes are tested using a brake dynamometer and defined brake cycles. The PMP protocol specifies that brake wear emissions have to be tested using the WLTP brake cycle. The speed profile of that cycle is shown here. During brake emissions testing, the WLTP cycle will need to be repeated multiple times. The exact number of replicates is still under discussion. It might be 10 or it might be a little bit fewer. But why does the protocol prescribe that one particular brake cycle must be used? Because using a different cycle is likely to produce different results for the exact same brake under test. In the left half of this plot, we see mean and peak brake temperatures in top and bottom respectively for brakes tested using the WLTP brake cycle, while on the right half, we see the exact same results for LACT. While brake temperature is not a final deliverable of the protocol, it does affect the final deliverables of particle measurements. So we'll touch back on this temperature theme a few more times throughout the webinar today. So while temperature is not a final deliverable, particle mass measurement is. Again, the left half is WLTP and the right half is LACT. Comparing left versus right then, we see differences in the emissions of PM10 in red and also in the PM10 to PM2.5 ratio in green. It's important then for the protocol to specify which test cycle should be used. But the dynamometer running that WLTP cycle is not sitting out in the open all by itself. It obviously needs to have an enclosure system around it to capture those particles created during braking and to transport them to measurement instruments. So this test stand has a lot of specifications, or the protocol has a lot of specifications for this test stand. To start, sections 2 through 4 pertain to the airflow. The velocity and volumetric flow rate of the air through the system have to be controlled. Different brake types need different air velocities. It also has to be ensured that the air in the enclosed system is clean. This is confirmed by conducting particle measurements when braking events are not occurring. A key measurement that's made during a braking event is brake temperature. Section 5 is dedicated to detailing how this measurement must be made. As shown in this image, thermocouples need to be embedded 0.5 millimeter deep into the brake disc surface, according to the PMP protocol. This thermocouple installation process happens before the brake is used. This effort at temperature measurement is made because there's evidence that during braking, uneven surface pressure distribution results in an uneven temperature distribution. Further, different decelerations, as shown in the top, middle, and bottom rows of this plot, result in different peak temperatures. Evolution of the temperature profile over time is shown moving from left to right. So let's focus on the rightmost column. When looking within one picture, we see that this temperature profile of the brake is spatially uneven. Some regions are hotter than others. Secondly, in the bottom row, so bottom right corner, we see that the deceleration with the highest initial speed of 200 kilometers per hour resulted in the highest brake temperatures. As we mentioned earlier, while temperature is not a final deliverable of the protocol, it does affect the final deliverables of particle mass and particle number measurements. To demonstrate the effect of temperature on PM, so mass measurements, this plot illustrates that as temperature increases, which is shown in the rising blue zigzag, so the stepwise blue line, number concentrations as measured by the TSI OPS in red rise as well. The OPS, or optical particle sizer, measures particles from 0.3 to 10 micrometers, so these particles are large enough to be relevant to particle mass measurements. While the concentration measured by the OPS, so the red data, does peak before the temperature does, it's possible that this is occurring because at those highest temperatures, brake pad materials are actually volatilizing instead of being mechanically worn away into those larger particle sizes. That volatilization of brake pad materials is then setting the stage for nucleation, the creation of smaller particles. To take a look then at the formation of those smaller particles, let's use a different instrument. Instead of the OPS, which can measure down to 0.3 microns, we will switch here to the FMPS. The Fast Mobility Particle Sizer, or FMPS, is very similar to the TSI EPS, with which you might be familiar. They can measure down to 5.6 nanometers. The blue block plot on the bottom here is actually a contour plot showing the entire size distribution as measured by the FMPS over time with 1 second resolution. The upper plot also has time on the horizontal axis, but it shows temperature as that uppermost dotted blue line. In this plot, we see that partway in, the temperature starts to rise. There's a corresponding rise in the red line, which is the number concentration as measured by FMPS. This total concentration has been driven up by that cloud of particles shown in the contour plot. The size distribution of the particles in that cloud is actually mostly made up of the smallest sizes around 10 nanometers. The figure labels these as being ultrafine particles generated by nucleation. Above that, there's a really pale cloud. It might be hard to see on your screen. And the figure labels that as fine particles generated mechanically. So from these data, we see that temperature is a key influencing factor for particle emissions and thus must be monitored via those embedded thermocouples. Now that the thermocouples are embedded, the brake is ready to be worn in. So a bedding in process is needed. The bedding in procedure is to be used as specified in section 6. Why is bedding in or this wearing in needed? As you might imagine, as a brand new brake pad is used, the emissions are not the same over the first few runs. In this plot, we see a series of peaks in different colors, but also that lone blue line. The lone blue line indicates speed, while all the others are particle number emissions. So the first thing we might notice is that the highest particle number emissions happened when the blue speed line was at its highest, around 100 kilometers per hour. So high initial speed braking events emit more particles. But the particle emissions during that event and all others are not stable as the brake pad is worn in. The particle number emissions were greatest during run 1 in orange and decreased for subsequent runs. In the interest of consistency, it would be advantageous to burn off these first few highest peaks before measurements begin, thus the need for a bedding in step. So we know that bedding in must be done. Does it matter how it's done? Yes, it does. Here we see the particle number emissions results from testing that occurred after three different bedding in procedures had been used. Further, emissions from a brake event with a particularly high initial speed, the 295th brake event within the WLTP, are shown in the paler colors, so a pale red, a pale green, a pale blue. And those differed really significantly depending on what bedding in procedure had been used prior to the beginning of this testing. So we know that bedding in is necessary and it needs to be done in a consistent fashion. So the PMP protocol has specified that 5 WLTP cycles should be run consecutively for the purpose of bedding in. This bedding in and all subsequent testing is performed on the brake when it's housed in an enclosure, as described in section 7. The size of the enclosure, positioning of the caliper, and rotation direction of the brake relative to the airflow are all specified. Here are two examples of enclosures used in brake wear emissions research. Section 7 also covers some aerosol-related best practices that pertain to the brake enclosure. The size of that enclosure must not permit excessive residence time, and internal surfaces should be smooth, and any changes in duct cross-section should be gradual. These aerosol best practices are used to reduce the losses of particles between the point of emission, which is obviously the brake, and the point of measurement. But while following these best practices from Section 7 will help reduce losses, it won't eliminate them completely. Losses are unavoidable. As such, they must be estimated, and data must be corrected using that estimation. There are several mechanisms for losses, as shown on the right. Gravitational settling is more significant with increasing particle size. Electrostatic losses are driven, of course, by charge. Using conductive materials throughout aerosol-related work is valuable for this reason. Non-conductive materials facilitate electrostatically driven losses. And in contrast to how gravitational settling is more important for larger particles, electrostatic or diffusional losses are more significant for smaller particles. Estimating losses can be done using several different techniques described in the protocol. One of them involves a particle size distribution of test aerosol that you generate into the duct. So in this strategy, you generate aerosol into the duct and you measure it in two different locations within the duct. So first for the generation part, the TSI 3410 dust aerosol generator is a useful tool. It can generate standard test dusts as well as a variety of other powders. This plot shows fine dust in green, coarse dust in pink, as well as soot and two other powders. So this generator is capable of a range of output concentrations and aerosol flow rates. Once those particles are introduced into the system, their concentration and size distribution have to be measured. Which sizing instrument is appropriate depends on which material will be aerosolized, which test dust. TSI has several different particle sizers that can be valuable tools for estimating losses in a breakwear emission system. Here we have from left to right the aerodynamic particle sizer, or APS, the engine exhaust particle sizer, or EEPS, and the scanning mobility particle sizer, or SMPS. We will touch more on sizing instrumentation during our research webinar later in the spring. But suffice it to say, these sizers can be very useful tools for estimating particle losses. Now that those loss estimates have been made, the final piece is in place for making accurate measurements of particle mass and particle number emissions. Of those two, the protocol addresses particle mass measurements first in section 9. The protocol uses the metrics of PM10 and PM2.5, which are particles smaller than 10 micrometers and 2.5 micrometers, respectively. Those are common metrics in ambient air quality. To optimize the measurement of these metrics for breakwear, there are specifications in the method for the design of the setup. These requirements pertain to bends in the airflow path and the radii of those bends, as well as the location of the sampling plane. The sampling plane is a vertical plane across the duct through which the system's air and particles are flowing. Further, and of importance for mass-based measurements, sampling at that plane must be conducted isokinetically. As you might infer, the word isokinetically means same speed. This is to indicate that the velocity of the air as it enters the sampling tube needs to match the speed just prior to and parallel to that sampling tube. So the air velocity in the sampling tube must match the air velocity in the duct. Matching these velocities ensures that larger particles are sampled in a representative fashion. In the figure on this slide, that's the left of the three figures. This is important because particle mass data is dominated by large particles, often just a relatively small number of those large particles. If the velocities don't match, as in the middle and the right-hand figures, large particles can either be undersampled or oversampled. Both of those scenarios result in inaccurate particle mass data. Once the particles are sampled isokinetically from the duct flow, they need to be collected, which is to say sampled, so that their mass can be measured later on. The primary way to sample the particulate matter is using a cyclonic separator followed by filtration. The purpose of the cyclone is to remove particles larger than the desired cut point, either 10 or 2.5 micrometers, depending on the design of the cyclone. Once this removal happens, all the air and all the remaining particles go out the top of the cyclone. They're captured on a filter, and that filter is then weighed, so its mass is measured. But that mass measurement is the last step in the process. The filter handling and weighing procedure looks like this. At left, brand new filters on which no samples have been collected must be preconditioned at a specified temperature and humidity. At the end of that preconditioning period, the initial mass is measured, then the sampling is done, and then that conditioning process has to be repeated before the final mass measurement can be taken. The purpose of these pre and post conditioning steps is to ensure that the amounts of water vapor adsorbed to the filter are comparable during the initial and final weighing stages. As an alternative to cyclone separators and filtration, inertial impactors can be used. Inertial impactors work by sampling air and particles into an impactor device and then forcing that air to make a sharp 90-degree turn. Those sharp turns can be easily followed by small particles, but larger particles won't be able to follow those air streamlines and they will crash into an impaction plate. Once this phenomenon happens in a cascading fashion, selecting for particles of progressively smaller size as the air goes through the device, it's called a cascade impactor. Due to the design of the impactor geometry, the size of particles collected at each stage is known. Consequently, cascade impactors can provide the user with a mass-based size distribution of the sampled aerosol. The impaction plates onto which the particles crash are actually covered by a substrate. Often aluminum foil or perhaps a filter, like maybe a Teflon membrane filter, can be used as a substrate. So the particles deposit to that substrate. Those substrates collect the particles, and after sampling, they're removed and weighed. TSI has a well-established line of cascade impactors called Moody impactors. Moody stands for Microorifice Uniform Deposition Impactor. These are widely used for ambient measurements, point source emissions characterization, and numerous other applications. Moody impactors as a family have been deployed around the world for years, and they're cited in many dozens of peer-reviewed published papers. For the application of break wear measurement, we recommend the model 100S4. This model has three stages with cut points at 10, 2.5, and 1 micrometers, which is a perfect fit for the PM10 and PM2.5 metrics required by the PMP protocol. Other Moody models are also available.
While mass-based measurements definitely have value, they do not capture the whole story. Some of you may already be familiar with number-based measurements, but for those who are not, we will describe this concept. As we mentioned before, mass-based measurements are dominated by a relatively small number of larger particles. This is purely because larger particles have so much more mass. For example, if particle A is 10 times larger than particle B by diameter, it is 1,000 times larger by mass. So from a mass perspective, particles of size B almost do not matter. What matters in mass-based measurements is, obviously, mass. Every nanogram counts the same, no matter the size of the particle from which that nanogram came. Number-based metrics have a different focus. Instead of every nanogram, every bit of mass counting the same, every single particle counts the same, regardless of how big or how small it is, regardless of how much or how little mass it contains. A 10 nanometer particle counts as one, and a 10 micron particle counts as one. The value of number-based metric is that it reveals the extent to which very small particles are present. Next slide, please. Here's one illustration of this idea. We have a particle size distribution of sorts where smaller particles are somewhat more numerous than larger particles. There are seven particle sizes here, each one step larger than the other. So the largest particle is only seven times larger than the smallest one. We can see that the mass distribution is dominated by the largest particles. The one largest particle makes up 29% of the total mass and almost 30% of the total mass, almost 70% of the total mass is contained in the top three particle sizes. From a number perspective, though, the opposite is true. Almost 70% in the bottom three sizes. Further in this slide, the particle sizes only differ by a factor of 7. In real life, that factor can be 100, so two orders of magnitude or even more. So you can see how different mass-based and number-based perspectives are. Next slide, please. While conventionally these smallest particles aren't thought in the past to be relevant to public health, after all, they don't have much mass, and public health regulations are focused on particle mass, thinking is beginning to change on that. Interest has been growing in Europe for measuring number concentrations too. This is because smaller particles are suspected of having negative health impacts that cannot be captured by mass-based metrics. The PMP method for break emissions requires that both mass-based and number-based measurements be made. Next slide, please. The number concentration measurements are detailed in section 10 of the PMP method. The number measurement system must contain removal of all particles larger than either 10 or 2.5 micrometers, a sampling line, dilution, and a condensation particle counter, or CPC. Diluting the sample prior to measurement is necessary because in some breaking events, the concentration of particles that results in the duct is high enough to exceed the upper concentration limit of the CPC. The diluter must be characterized for losses at three different particle sizes. The resulting PCRF, or particle concentration reduction factor, values are then averaged and applied to all CPC data. Section 10 also provides requirements for the CPC. First, it must be a full flow CPC, which means that all of the flow that enters the instrument inlet must go through the optics. Secondly, the counting efficiency of the CPC must be such that it can detect 10 nanometer particles successfully 65% of the time, plus or minus 15%. Further, the CPC must detect 15 nanometer particles successfully in more than 90% of the time. Next slide, please. While the CPC is critical to break wear measurements, CPCs are also a great strength of TSI. We have been designing and manufacturing CPCs for nearly four decades. As such, we have two models of CPC that are suitable for break wear measurements. The top row shows the 3798-10, which is an older model and it's already calibrated at the sizes required by the PMP protocol. In the bottom row is a newer generation of CPC, the 3750. We have tested a special calibration of this CPC model for purposes of brake wear measurement. Both of these CPCs are full flow CPCs and allow all sampled aerosols to be taken into account, and they both meet the counting efficiency requirements. Next slide, please. The key differences between these two CPCs are shown here. The 3798-10 has an upper concentration limit of 50,000 particles per cubic centimeter, while the newer generation can measure up to a twofold higher concentration. Further, the newer generation CPC can communicate with the diluter we will introduce next, better enabling the measurement of high concentrations of brake wear particles. Next slide, please. So this is the diluter solution. It is designed to work with the 3750 CPC, both in terms of flow rate and in terms of communications. It provides a controlled 10-to-1 dilution ratio and communicates the actual ratio and the relevant control parameters to the CPC 3750. Consequently, dilution data are stored right alongside particle data. These instruments working together can provide particle number measurements required by the PMP protocol. Next slide, please. It should be noted that the protocol requires only measurement of the total particle number concentration, regardless of those particles' composition. We've seen data sets today, though, that demonstrates that as brake temperature increases, brake pad material is volatilizing, increasing the particle number emissions. These particles are forming from nucleation of volatilized species without the presence of a solid core within the particle. The PMP protocol recommends, but as of now does not require, measurements of solid particles in addition to measurements of total particles. To measure solid particles, a sample stream must be thermally treated to re-volatilize the material making up the non-solid particles. When this happens, the particles no longer exist, but the sample must then be diluted again to prevent renucleation. To demonstrate, next slide, please. To demonstrate how significant of an effect these volatile particles have on the measurement of total particles, let's have a look at this data from Mamakos et al. Here, APC or AVL particle counter in red indicates particle measurement or particles measured in a branch of the experiment that includes thermal treatment, so a solid particles measurement. While UCPC, which stands for ultrafine CPC, or a TSI 3776 that has a D50 of 2.5 nanometers only, indicates total particles, so that branch is not thermally treated. Error bars on the red APC points account for both particle losses internal to the APC and also the difference in the counting efficiencies between the APC and the ultrafine CPC. Here we see that the red APC branch, which is thermally treated, is measuring lower particle emissions than the blue UCPC total branch, thus suggesting that some of the particles were formed via nucleation and are made up of volatile compounds. Because of this non-trivial contribution of volatile particles, it can be valuable to measure both total and solid particle number emissions. At least it is mandatory to know what fraction you are measuring. Next slide, please. Now that both particle mass and particle number measurements have been made, the brake wear emission measurement system has produced a great deal of data. How much of it must be reported? Section 11 specifies this, detailing which parameters must be reported for the brake, cooling air, deceleration rate, friction coefficient, and particle data. The frequencies at which the data must be reported, for example 10 Hz, are also specified. Next slide, please. And all of this data must go into a report, a specified or of a specified format. Section 11 requires that the file formats EEC or EED must be used. EEC shall include one row for each brake deceleration event, and EED shall include data sampling at, for example, 1 Hz. They are agnostic to the technology or software used in the brake wear measurement system and produce an Excel or CSV, so basically an ASCII type of output file. Next slide, please. So we've covered the entire PMP protocol for break emissions. To review it briefly, it specifies that the WLTP break cycle must be used. It provides specific details as to how the test setup must be designed and operated. It gives guidance as to how to estimate particle losses within the test setup as well. TSI has several helpful instruments here, like the 3410 dust aerosol generator, as well as several particle sizes. After this come the requirements of particle mass measurements, where the 100 SV Moody impactor can be used. Lastly, TSI strength and particle counting fields the need for particle number measurements with CPCs and appropriate dilution. Given the complexity of this application, successful integration is key to obtain accurate data. One may consider working with an integrator who is experienced with this application. Next slide, please. So let's take a couple of seconds to check with our outline. We've covered the motivation and goals and have completed our discussion of the PMP protocol for breakwell measurements. Let's now turn our attention to some example data that can be produced by a system that meets the specifications of the PMP protocol. We will start with data types that are required by the protocol, PM and PN, and then we will move into additional data types that can be valuable together, even though they are not currently required.
So let's think back to the goal of the protocol. If you're a brake manufacturer, you want to know the particle emissions, particles emitted per kilometer or per mile driven, for a particular brake product. So in that vein, here's an example of very much the type of data that this protocol is aiming for. Hesse and colleagues tested three different brake discs. Gray cast iron discs are shown here as GCI, tungsten carbide coated discs are shown as HMC, and carbon ceramic discs are shown as CC. Here we see clear differences in PM10 in blue, PM2.5 in orange, and PN in green dots among these three brake disc materials. So disc composition clearly affects particle mass and particle number emissions. Pad composition also affects the relationship between particle number emissions and brake temperature. As we know, higher brake temperatures lead to a spike in PN emissions due to volatilization and subsequent nucleation. There's a critical temperature at which this steep increase happens, a sort of threshold phenomenon. When one moves, or the critical temperature varies by brake pad composition. If you move from an organic binder material to an inorganic binder material, that critical temperature, that threshold, moves up. In this case, it moved from 180 Celsius to 240 degrees Celsius. And that pad composition also affects final particle composition naturally. Here, Hagino and colleagues present mass-based size distributions of five elements in breakware particles emitted from the three vehicles they tested, as well as the total PM distribution. That total PM distribution is in the upper left corner, so let's start there. Here we can see that vehicle 2 in blue certainly emitted more mass, particularly around the particle size of 1 micrometer. But while vehicle 2 did emit more mass overall, it did not emit more of every element. It emitted much more iron, as shown in the upper right, and some more antimony in the lower row in the middle, but it emitted less aluminum, copper, and barium relative to vehicle 1. Such information is valuable for researchers, and it may also have utility for manufacturers. Lastly, the particle emissions over the course of a protocol-compliant test, even though bedding in was performed, are not always constant. Recall that the WLTP cycle has to be repeated numerous times in succession during a test, according to the protocol. While the final emissions calculation presumably encompasses the emission over all of those repeats, it's not the case that emissions are identical during each of those repeats. Here we see the third, fifth, and eighth repetition of the 295th brake event, that initial high-speed event, in the WLTP cycle. In the bottom row, you can see the total counts in red and blue. Recall that the red APC line represents thermally treated aerosol, and the blue ultrafine CPC line represents total aerosol. The red line is occasionally higher than the blue. The authors explain that this is due to overcorrecting for losses within that red instrument. So setting that aspect aside, you can generally see that the number concentrations are not identical across the three repeats. Concentrations do seem to elevate as the repetitions proceed, but the change isn't major. When you look at the contour plots above, though, that provides size information, you can see substantial differences among the repetitions. The eighth at far right has that big yellow and orange bloom of particles. They're very small particles that were totally absent at left. Volatilization and nucleation are likely occurring to a greater extent in the later repetitions. So the size of the emitted particles changes with cycle repetition, but the number data alone does not reveal this fact. Such size differences and the likely composition differences that go with them have implications for the fate, transport, and impacts of such particles. Because of those implications, it's valuable to have sizing capability included in a breakware test stand. We will go over these sizing capabilities as well as other instrumentation in our second webinar on this in this series, which is focused on research. If you'd like to register for that webinar, you can do so at this link. This will be included when the slides are sent out to all of the registrants for today's webinar. To summarize today's webinar then, measuring break emissions is complex. There are many parameters to track and the generated particles are measured in more than one way. The PMP protocol provides standardization. This saves investigators time and ensures that the resulting data from multiple parties will be intercomparable. TSI instruments are a valuable part of a complete solution that is compliant with the PMP protocol. Given the complexity of the system, though, consider working with an experienced integrator to ensure success of your breakware emissions efforts. For your reference, then, we have a bibliography of all papers containing data that we've discussed today, as well as the Matheson paper that describes the WLTP break cycle. So with that, thank you very much for your attention today, and we'll be happy to take any questions at this time. If I turn to the Q&A panel, I see one question asking for the copy of the slides. And yes, the slides will be sent out to all registrants.
I see a question here how CPCs are calibrated. There's even application notes on our website, or if you drop us an email, we can send you further information. Basically, a CPC is validated or calibrated against a system that is providing SI units. So that would be an electrometer. So you have a system where you feed the setup with highly monodispersed aerosols, different sizes, and then compare the number concentration from the CPC to test versus a reference CPC or a reference electrometer or both. And TSI is offering all the solutions to build up a complete test bench to do calibration on your own, if you like. Otherwise, you can send your CPCs to TSI for calibration. Another question I fear probably related to that, how all setup is evaluated for reliable PMP measurements? That's a very good question. I'm not aware of an office that is going around and testing a final setup. All of my customers are either part of the current PMP group or they are in connection with stakeholders of the PMP group. So regarding the measurements like the CPC or the break dynamometer and so forth, this is more or less clear. There's other things taken into account. For example, the cooling air you use for the test duct, you need to make sure to have very good HEPA filters because this is typically a loop. So you need to make sure you do not have any contamination coming from other sources than from your current break test duct. So, but this is breakware application is tested with particle sizes and CPCs for almost 10 years, I would say. And so a lot of work has been done. And I don't know how a final test for a new office or a new lab will be, but I'm quite sure there will be some offerings by the PMP group as well.
So I see a question here. Do you plan any real world roadside measurements? That's a very interesting question. These tests are being conducted in this protocol on a dynamometer, right? So it's controlled. Controlled is beneficial in terms of intercomparability, repeatability, but it's not going to be identical to reality, right? So I know there are conversations going on. How would you measure brake dust where the measurement is happening on board a vehicle that's driving in real life? So I certainly know that that conversation is going on within the community. To my knowledge, I think the instrumentation and the whole integrated system that would be on board is not fully prepared yet. So that would be something that we would be happy to participate in, but I'm not aware of any concrete plans in that regard as of now. Another question, does the guidance include collection of samples for elemental analysis? That's a great question. The PMP protocol does not require elemental or chemical in any way analysis, but that's certainly a very, very relevant research question that people have been looking at. So our impactors would be a really, really valuable tool for that, and we will address sample analysis in our research webinar.
I have supported customers doing so. So just one more comment, it's very hard to sample very small particle sizes. So for sample analysis for the larger ones, so micrometer, super micrometer size, that's fairly easy. And for all size channels, you will find the stainless steel that is coming from the disc of the break, but really looking into the, let's say, sub 300 or sub 100 nanometer to do sample analysis is really more for the research than for the standard test protocol, because it sounds like a lot of particles, but in terms of Mars and the small particles, it is not the case. So sample offline analysis is not so easy.
We have a question about how global is this PMP task force that developed this protocol. I can with confidence say that it is not purely European in its makeup. We have key players from multiple parties within the breakware community, including parties from North America who are in that PMP group. I imagine that parties from Asia are also present in that PMP group, but I can't say that confidently. I don't remember the full participant or member list off the top of my head. So I think the full intention is for that protocol to be globally relevant.
I have a question here. Are the shape of the particles regular? Or if not, how reliable are the measurements, or how do the instruments deal with that? That's a great question too. I have not seen any, let's say, fiber-like particles from these type of measurements, but I also have to say that I was only working with like low steel brake pads or non-asbestos organic, so nothing that contains asbestos or any other kind of fiber, so I haven't seen it. For the instruments, if you're looking for a CPC, the CPC doesn't care about the aspect ratio, as long as it's not like a super long fiber. Fast size or SMPS is based on electrical mobility and not on the aspect ratio as well. If you use an APS is measuring the true aerodynamic diameter. So that even takes this into account. But I think it's not so critical as for other applications.
I see a question here about train or heavy duty brake emissions. The scope of the PMP protocol, as of now, to my knowledge, is light duty vehicles. I know there's interest for train braking emissions and heavy duty brake emissions. Heavy duty brake emissions can be a significant part of the overall vehicle emissions, given the progress that has been made on diesel engine emissions in recent years. I'm sure that this protocol could be used as a valuable stepping stone towards developing protocols for those other vehicle types. But to my knowledge, method development for those other vehicle types is not currently as far along as this light duty vehicle type. I also have another question. Can we explain how isokinetic sampling was maintained in the sampling tunnel? So if the linear speed at a certain point or at any given moment, if the linear speed within the tunnel is not exactly the same, if it deviates a little bit, perhaps due to temperature or some fluctuation in the air handling system, this sampling would no longer be perfectly isokinetic. And I think as long as it's within a certain percentage of isokinetic, it's okay. It's possible to calculate the impact on your sampling efficiency of particles of a certain size you would be if your speed is off by X percent. So that's, you can vary, how far am I in speed and what particle size am I looking at and get a big matrix, right, of how far off of isokinetic, how far off of representative sampling you are. So there's some bounds there.
I have another question here. Do the losses you see at smaller particle sizes vary across material type? I haven't seen it yet. One reason might be that the whole test stack, everything is made of metal, so you avoid something like charge-based losses, so like electrostatic losses. Also, you have a lot of air masses going around with that is like cool. So thermophoretic deposition or losses are also not considered and are not found. I actually have one very, very large breakware manufacturer who did test directly at the test duct itself and also further downstream in the system where they recycle the airflow. And the sizing results they get are very similar. It's shifting slightly with time, but this is due to the high concentration when the size distribution is reforming. So that means by coagulation, the large particles eat up, so to say, the smaller particles and so forth, and agglomeration processes that may occur. This is leading to changes, which is why it is important where you take the sample. But I haven't seen different losses characteristics from different break pad materials so far. Andrea, do you have more questions?
I do not as of now, unless I've missed something scrolling past it. Yes, we will be sharing the presentation. So yes, that'll go out to everybody.
Super. I just have very last one. What is the recombinant flow rate or velocity through the test break enclosure? I don't have it on top of my head, but we can share that with you afterwards. And I'm quite sure that's also mentioned in the PMP protocol.
It is mentioned in the protocol, and it depends on the break type. So the size of the break and or weight of the vehicle, there are certain parameters there, and they've categorized them and said for things that fall in this range, you need this flow rate or this velocity. So that's all specified in the protocol. If you're interested in further details, please feel free to email us, and we can take that conversation offline.
Super. With that, thank you again. Have a good rest of the day, and hope to see you soon in the research part of breakware measurements. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.